Hachette Audio presents Movie Freak, My Life Watching Movies, written and read by Owen Gleiberman. For my mother, and for Sharon, Lily, and Sadie, who save me every day. So you think you're a Romeo playing a part in a picture show? Supertramp, take the long way home. Preface. So how do you get to be a film critic? In my life, that's the question I've been asked more than any other. I get asked it at parties, on playgrounds, in apartment hallways, in offices, on airplanes, on movie lines. There are a handful of other questions that run a close second. Questions like, how many movies do you see a week? About 5 or 6. Do you take notes? Yes, always. Do film studios ever try to influence your opinion? They wouldn't dare. Have you ever had your words twisted in a movie ad? Once in a blue moon. What's your all-time favorite movie? Robert Altman's Nashville. The questions generally get asked with a knowing smile, a slight winking tone of, come on, let me in on it. In the popular imagination, the job of professional film critic is more or less the greatest job in the world. It's one that everybody thinks they would want to do. It's one that everybody thinks deep down they could do. You watch movies, lots of them, all day long. You write down your opinions of them. You get to see your words quoted in ads, your name up in lights. You become sort of famous. What's not to like? There's an avid curiosity, and always has been, about what critics do. Just beneath that, though, the real curiosity is about who we are. When people pepper me with all those questions, what they're really saying is, what gives you the right to be a critic? What makes you so special that you, as opposed to, say, they, get to spend your entire life watching movies, deciding which of them is good or bad and why? It's actually a great question, and it deserves a great answer. Let's get one thing out of the way fast. If you have any notion that this profession is, on some essential level, ridiculous, that it's simply fun beyond all shame, and that those of us who do it are basically slackers dignified by their salaries, well, to quote Martin Sheen in Apocalypse Now, you are absolutely goddamn right. The role of professional movie critic is more or less the cushiest job that Western civilization ever coughed up. Maybe that's one reason why criticism is now dwindling. As Western civilization declines, so go the people who were fortunate enough to make a living not creating art or entertainment, but evaluating it. I admit it, I've been one lucky sucker. That said, there's a dimension to being a critic that tends to get left out of people's I wish I had a job as lazy as yours formulations. And that dimension, in a word, is obsession. It's the thing that I've tried to capture in this book. I wanted to write about what you might call the secret history of being a movie fanatic, and what that really involves. For the truth about movie buffs, and film critics especially, is that there's a kind of religious mania that drives us, and you either have it or you don't. Before anything else, the primal act in our lives is going to the movies by ourselves, sitting there alone, with a nearly monastic sense of mission, connecting with images of life and reality on the big screen, even as, in doing so, we may be copping out on the very reality those images represent. I've been fortunate, all right, but not just because I stumbled into a preposterously enjoyable job. The real stroke of luck is that I was able to elevate the nerd madness of my solitary movie passion into an identity, an existence, a personality-defining role. The world, of course, now overflows with mad geek obsessives of every stripe, comic book fans, sportsaholics, Sudoku addicts. But what's unique about movies as an art form is how totally and vividly and spectacularly they create a you-are-there facsimile of life as it really looks, a fully realized alternate Earth that the critic inhabits and lives inside. In writing this book, my intent was to channel the deep eccentricity of that pursuit, to get in touch with the elemental weirdness of rabid film fanaticism. In my case, the weirdness isn't exactly compartmentalized. I'm kind of an obsessive guy in all ways. But then that's part of what drew me to movies, which feed off obsession as though it were high-octane gasoline. We now live in an age of pop culture fixation, in which our country has evolved into the United States of Entertainment, with a great many other places right behind it. For all the justified chatter about the Renaissance era of television, movies, in their power and grandeur and reach, their mythological scope, their ability to cast a larger-than-life spell in the dark, remain our stubbornly thriving and preeminent popular art form. The critic, in a sense, is the ultimate fan, but he's also the bridge between movies and the people who voraciously devour them. I've tried to set down an honest account of my experience, but I'm the first to admit that it may all seem a bit insular. The true confessions of a film critic? Of a person who watches movies too much? That sounds like a book that should be entitled White People Problems 3.0. Yet take a look around. We've become a veritable society of watchers. I hope that my story will speak to the movie freak who lives inside so many of us. Chapter 1. I Lost It at the Drive-In. The oversized letter U loomed up large at the entrance to the university drive-in theater. Filled with dozens of tiny hot pink light bulbs, the letter dazzled and glowed like it was made of lit-up bubblegum. And that felt right, since what this candified gateway heralded was a carnival of excess. It promised delights of a totally indulgent nature. Ah, the drive-in movie theater. It's up there with the bowling alley, the $2 pisswater beer dive bar, and the Friday night high school football game as a tawdry specimen of Americana, a destination of low-kitsch nostalgic charm. The drive-in offers, or at least it once did, a movie-going experience that is wholesomely amusing in a slightly scuzzy way. One thinks of tailgate parties and hot summer makeout sessions, of monster movies and kung fu movies and Burt Reynolds' idiot car chase movies. But in 1967, when I was 8 years old, and 1968, when I was 9, the drive-in for me became a place of debased enchantment, a seductive theater of cruelty in which the curtain was drawn back on things I never ever should have seen. During those 2 years, mostly in the summer, my father, showing the combination of antsy compulsive desire and near total indifference to his family's needs that would mark so much of his existence, developed a highly charged curiosity about the newly taboo-busting movies for adults that had begun to dot the American motion picture landscape. My dad hadn't been a movie fan for quite some time. His most dedicated era of moviegoing was his youth, in the 30s and 40s, when you could still buy a ticket to a Saturday double feature for 15 cents. He'd been mourning the rise in ticket prices ever since. One of the forms his pathological cheapness took was not ever fully accepting the concept of inflation. He had once taken me to see a Hitchcock film. It was Sabotage, which in my 7-year-old way I enjoyed, and he came out of it muttering that Hitchcock, was a fraud, that his movies were, quote, parrot shit. Normally, for my dad, the prospect of hauling his family off to a movie would have been as far from his mind as taking them on an expedition to Saturn. Yet for all my father's outward plaid jacket conservatism, the world of late 60s sex and violence struck a chord in him. It was only years later when I learned of his serial adultery and saw that he'd been a Jewish Don Draper in horn rims, that I realized how much his inner appetites connected with the times. Piling my mother, myself, and my two little brothers, 3-year-old Eric and 2-year-old Stefan, into the family Buick, he fed his appetites and literally took us along for the ride. During those 2 years, I saw twisted, sordid visions that haunted my head at far too tender an age. It was as if I was losing my cinematic virginity at a very skanky whorehouse. Movie Bus will tell you a story about how the first time their eyes popped open in wonder at the cinema, it was when they saw The Wizard of Oz or Citizen Kane or 2001 A Space Odyssey or The Godfather or Jaws. For me, it was all about seeing the devil rape Rosemary before I was old enough to know what the devil or rape was. And the thing is, I drank up every depraved, inappropriate minute of it, even if it was the movie-going equivalent of borderline child abuse. There's something inescapably cozy about a drive-in movie theater. Jerry Seinfeld used to tell a very Jerry monologue joke about why he likes to drive so much because you're inside and outside at the same time. At the drive-in, you weren't just inside and outside. You were part of an entire audience from which you remained separate, a hermetically sealed movie-going horde. I suspect that if my family had been there to see The Jungle Book or Dr. Doolittle, the experience would have been very warm and toasty in that leftover 1950s way. Instead, for me, there was a disturbingly sinister excitement to it. To get to the drive-in, you had to leave the woodsy hills and boulevards of our hometown of Ann Arbor, Michigan, and go out to a flat, drab no-man's land, to badly lit roads with names like...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.